Hello and welcome back to Switch and Lever. Before we kick things off, this video may contain sounds of questionable musical quality. If you are accustomed to nice smooth sounds, I would suggest looking for a smooth jazz playlist. In fact, one of my favorites is linked in the description already. This video is about taking children's toys and making them do things they were not intended to do. Now, don't take toys from children. It's better all around if you forgo the crying and angry parents and instead head over to your local thrift store to see what's available. I managed to get my hand on this Music Time My First Keyboard for close to no money at all. In all respects, this is a really decent kids' keyboard. It has a whole bunch of instruments to choose from, which are actually surprisingly decent for being in a toy. It also has some tunes you can play and even some groovy animal sounds. Before we get carried away though, let's talk a little about what we're doing. I'm sure some of you are wondering why I haven't mentioned circuit bending yet, so let's talk about the elephant in the room. Circuit bending isn't about actually bending any circuits. Rather, it's about altering the circuits in musical toys and instruments to make them do weird and wonderful things. By adding different components, such as resistors, potentiometers, buttons, or capacitors, you change the behavior of the sounds. By their nature, most of these sounds are glitchy and noisy, suited for music on the electronical side of the spectrum. But sometimes you're able to create some truly inspiring sounds as well. To get started, you're of course going to need your toy, which luckily we already have. It's also helpful if you have an assortment of different electronic components already, as the nature of circuit bending is to experiment and not to know what you need beforehand. Personally, I have a hoarder instinct and I like salvaging interesting components and knobs from various broken electronics which cross my path. For this particular hack, you're also going to need a switching 3.5mm audio jack, but I'll get back to that later. Some general tools like screwdrivers and side cutters are also a good idea. You're also definitely going to need a soldering iron, like this TS100 soldering iron I was sent to test out. But again, more on that later. Start by cracking open your toy, and by crack open I mean carefully undo the screws that are holding it together. Once inside, we get direct access to the circuit that's making this keyboard chooch. We have a slew of resistors, transistors, and capacitors, which are all basically part of driving the speaker. The interesting part is under this epoxy blob, that's the brain of this thing, and it's completely inaccessible. Luckily for us though, it appears that most points are broken out into a ribbon cable connected to the main circuit board. The best way to really get started is just to grab some jumper wires and start poking around. Play a note repeatedly on the keyboard, or if it plays music by itself, make sure that it's playing. Connect points together and make careful notes what happens when you connect them. There is a real risk of frying the circuit, so be careful if you ever see sparks, do not connect those points again. Also, this is why you should not do this on expensive equipment and only work with battery-powered circuitry. Do not try to circuit bend any device which runs on mains power. It can result in serious injury or even death if you poke in the wrong place. Even so, it's likely that you're going to crash the circuit of your toy repeatedly, so be ready to turn it on and off to reset it. Unless you really fried it, it should spring back to life. The simplest hack to make is to change the pitch, and it's usually just controlled by a pitch resistor somewhere in the circuit. You can find this by hooking up jumper cables to a potentiometer, which is essentially just a variable resistor, and connect to any of the resistors. Once you find the pitch resistor, you'll notice that you can change the pitch of the tone played by turning the potentiometer knob. Removing and permanently replacing this resistor with a potentiometer gives you a way to easily adjust the pitch on the fly. What value of potentiometer you need depends on the circuit. which is why it's very handy to have an assortment of potentiometers available to be able to experiment which gives the best result. To get the desired result, I ended up having to use the highest value potentiometer I had at 1 mega ohm. As we're getting ready to solder, let's go back and talk a little bit about the TS100 soldering iron. Full transparency, I was sent this by Gearbest for testing, but I had already seen quite a few people on YouTube revel about it, so I knew I had to give it a try. The soldering iron comes in this sleek black box, nicely packaged with a quick start guide and a solder tip. The iron feels more like a pen than a soldering iron. It's light, but therefore it also feels nimble in the hand. The iron runs on anywhere between 12 to 24 volts, but will heat up quicker at the higher rated voltage. I ran it at 12 volts, as that's what I had available, and it still heated up to 350 degrees Celsius in just around half a minute, which I found quite reasonable. The tips of the soldering iron are also replaceable and comes in different shapes for different purposes. The question is, how does it hold up to soldering? Let's get back to the circuit bending and find out. As we mentioned before, the pitch resistor needs to go. That's the easy part though, just grab it with pliers or tweezers, heat up the solder pads and pull out the leads. From this point on, the keyboard will not work until we replace the resistor with our potentiometer. Of course, we can't mount the potentiometer inside the enclosure, it needs to stick out somewhere. Use a drill, or like I'm doing, a Dremel, to cut out some holes where the components can fit through the front and the sides of the enclosure for the different parts that you want to mount. As we're installing an audio out jack, now is also a good time to figure out where that needs to go, as well as any other components you want to fit in based on your explorations. I'm adding a couple of toggle switches, as well as something called body contacts. If it's easy to get to the components with the soldering iron when they're mounted, I see no harm in attaching them before starting to attach wires. When you have wires going back and forth connecting points, things do get a little bit messy. Here I'm attaching two brass drawer pulls, which will form our body contacts. Basically what they do is allow us to change the pitch of our tones simply by touching the knobs and allowing our bodies to act as big resistors. It literally allows you to bend the sound being played by altering how you touch the contacts. Therefore, they need to be conductive, so metal is the way to go. We'll get back to them in a second though. In the meanwhile, let's turn our attention to the audio jack. You can choose here if you want a switched audio jack or a regular one. The benefit of a switched one is that you can cut the signal to the speaker whenever you plug in headphones. This means that you can sit and play by yourself without bothering anyone. And when you're ready for a performance, just unplug your headphones and the speaker will kick in again. Though if you want to record what you're playing into a separate audio recorder, that may be a bit difficult as you won't be able to hear what you're playing unless the audio recorder has an audio out of itself. For this reason, you may want to choose a non-switched audio jack. Disconnect the speaker and connect the signal from the keyboard to the audio jack instead, and the switched leads back to the speaker. Now you're ready to start hooking up other components. Start by hooking up the potentiometer to replace the pitch resistor. I added a toggle switch to switch between using the potentiometer and the body contacts as the pitch control, and also connected a high-value resistor between the body contacts so that they're always connected, as I found out that the keyboard would crash if they weren't. I also added a capacitor between a point in the audio circuit through another toggle switch and to a point on the small controller board. When flipped, this causes a noise to be played whenever certain high tones are reached. I'm being somewhat deliberately vague in what points to use, exact values of components, and so forth, because unless you have this exact keyboard, it will not matter. Circuit bending is an inexact science. Heck, it's probably not even a science at all. Grab a fistful of random components, throw them at your circuit, see what sticks, and solder stuff in place. Your mileage will vary, and what you use in your hack will no doubt share similarities with this, but still be entirely different. The one thing we have left to do before we close her up is to make sure all components are attached properly. Some, which have nuts, you may be able to screw in from the outside. The plastic was quite thick in some places, so this only worked for the toggle switches for me. Luckily though, as you can see already, hot glue comes in very handy to both secure components in place, as well as insulating exposed wires and solder points from short circuiting. Don't be shy with the hot glue. Unless you're planning to remove the components, it's better to use a bit too much hot glue than too little. Finally, put the back on. Attach a knob if you feel like sprucing up the shaft of your potentiometer, and get ready to fire this baby up. From here on out, I don't think there's a need for words. Although I do apologize that instead of my smooth southern comfort and pipe smoking cured voice, you get to listen to something barely qualifiable as music. Okay, you made it through, you're alive, and hopefully your eardrums are intact. Let's close up the chapter on the TS-100 soldering iron. I've used it now for a few weeks, and aside from this project, I've used it to desolder components as well as build some other small circuits. I have to say that I'm thoroughly impressed. I'm used to running a proper Weller soldering station, and while they're truly great irons, this is a serious contender for sure. Not the least because it's so small, I can easily bring it with me whenever I may need it. I was surprised over how much I actually like this soldering iron, and I was expecting to make another scathing review, but that didn't happen. Another cool feature is that because it has a USB connector, you can upgrade the firmware, and you're not just locked into the manufacturer's firmware either. There are people who have made their own custom firmware that unlocks a lot more options and features than what the iron ships with. For instance, who wouldn't want to have their own logo during startup? If you feel like getting this soldering iron, there is a link in the description. As before, I don't gain anything if you buy this iron or not. None of the links in the description are affiliate links. Now, there were some issues with this build. like having to switch between the body contacts and the pitch potentiometer, the lowest pitch not being low enough for my taste, and the audio jack only working on the right channel. I couldn't leave good enough alone, even though the video was almost done. So I fixed those issues and added another couple of features for good measure. I removed one of the toggle switches and replaced it with a button which creates some really god-awful noise. I also added a slide potentiometer in series with the pitch potentiometer, effectively doubling the lower pitch effect. The audio signal out of the audio jack was also unreasonably high, making the use of headphones unbearably loud. Another potentiometer was therefore added as a separate volume control for the outgoing signal. Now go forth and create. I chose to hack a keyboard because I wanted a playable instrument, but there is nothing stopping you from using any sort of toy which makes noise for your hacks. This toy remote control, for instance, picked up for a dollar, fitted with a pitch potentiometer, and it now makes some delightfully weird sounds. I hope you enjoyed this video. If your ears can take more abuse, be sure to check out one of the previous videos from Switch and Lever. For a less loud venue, head over to Instagram for more regular updates. Until next time!